Giants, they will rise and fall. God, you stand above them all. Seasons, they will come and go, but you will stay the same. And even when I'm weak and worn, you are able to restore. And every time my heart is torn, I'll praise you even more. And I will say, Prince of Peace, I'm resting in your victory, Jesus, I am yours.
Church, and we're excited to get things rolling here. If you would all please stand and join us with This Is Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
this morning, Pastor is out, and we have Phil that's going to give our message this morning. And Phil, so we've done this song before, Wonderful Grace of Jesus, so you guys all know this one. Phil sent me a video of a version that was a little bit different, and it's really cool. It's actually a lot of fun, but it's going to take some participation on your guys' part to do this one. So the ladies up front, they're going to cue the ladies in the congregation to come in on some echo parts, all right? So when we get to the chorus, men, you just got to hit it hard. And then ladies, when it's time, there's going to be some echoes. And the ladies here are going to give you a cue. And there's also going to be color codes on the screen to kind of guide you, all right? So we're going to have some fun. If, you know, if we're all not all together, hey, you guys aren't paid, we're not paid, and that's okay. We're going to have fun. We're going to worship God and have a good time here. So, Wonderful Grace of Jesus. We need the drums in. There we go. All right.
Thank you.
guys will all have to get on Facebook, look at the recording, and listen, and see how you did. I think it was pretty good. I think it went pretty well. All right, so let's take some time for announcements. Do we have any announcements for the good of the cause this morning? Carrie, do you?
So 3 weeks from yesterday is our youth conference coming up on March 12th. We're looking for people to help with that and all kinds of people. We need people for kid control. We need people for prayer time, for just our breakout sessions, just getting kids to the high school and back for activity. Anything that you feel that you can help us out with, we would love your help. And most importantly, I know that every single one of you in this building can do that, is prayer, because these kids need prayer. So, and the leaders and the helpers all need prayer. So I'm just asking for that especially, but if you can help with donating food or time, that's huge. So we're asking for that. It's coming around the corner really fast, and we're excited about it. We have 5 speakers coming for that day. We have, like I said, activity. There will be 2 meals. They'll have lunch and supper here. And we're just praising God that we can do this. So thank you ahead for all your help with that.
I'll just steal Phil's mic. Along with the youth conference, we're also having a sign-up sheet. We're doing a prayer vigil that entire day that the youth conference is going on. We want it to be continuous, nonstop prayer. So you can find a sheet just like this one out there in the entryway on that cabinet that's whatever, east side. I'm not good with north, south, east, and west. It's about a 30-minute time slot. You can pray for more than one 30-minute time slot if you want to. We will be praying here at the church, and we need at least one person for every time slot. So once again, that's going to be going all day long during the conference from 9:30 in the morning until 8 o'clock at night. So as many names as possible would be great to come here that day. And once I get the list, I will contact you before the conference to let you know exactly how that's going to work out.
Thanks, Janelle. Anybody else have announcements for the good of the cause? All right, Jesus Messiah.
He humbled himself and carried the cross. Let's open in prayer. Lord God Almighty, you are all-powerful, all-knowing, and you are our salvation. It's through you and you alone, and we thank you for that. We thank you for this church, for the chance to get together and worship you and learn about your word and study and become better able to reach out to our community. Pray that you would help us to shine in our community, that people would see us and glorify you. Thank you for that. Think of those that are not with us today because of illness or whatever. Pray that you would heal them. Bring them back to full strength. Encourage those who are down and struggling. And we thank you that you have sent your Holy Spirit to live in us, to work in us, that we can be an encouragement to the people around us. Be with our nation. Pray that you would help our nation to turn to you so that we can follow and serve you also better. In your name, amen. When Lynn asked me to do this, I told him I'd pray about it, and then I'd go look a little bit, and I came across a verse in Romans right away. And I'm going to read it right now, Romans chapter 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. And I looked at that and I thought, that's an outline. There's four good points in there, at least, of what we can do in serving God. As we've been working on this church and putting things together, one of the things Lynn has really pushed us to do is to get a vision statement, and we did that finally a little while ago. It says to create a fellowship that builds a relationship with Jesus Christ through the teaching of his word. Now, I want to build on that a little bit, but our vision is to teach people about Jesus Christ, to share the good news with them so that they will know who God is and what he has done for them. When we first started putting that together, we went back to a verse in Ephesians. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12, and it says, and he gave some as apostles, some as prophets, some as evangelists, and some as pastors and teachers, for the equipping of the saints for the work of service to the building up of the body of Christ. Two key phrases in there, for the equipping of the saints and the building up of the body of Christ. You are the saints. You may not feel like it very often. I know I don't always feel like a saint. Maybe never. But we, as a group, are the saints that are here to build up the body of Christ. That's what we're here to do. We're here to learn about God, to serve him, to learn his word, and then go out those doors and share that good news with the people around us. I grew up as a missionary kid, and so as a missionary kid, you end up in a lot of missionary conferences. So we would be in Africa for 4 or 5 years, and then we'd come back to America and spend a whole year going from church to church. And there would be a lot of conferences, and they would use verses to work in those for a key verse in the conference. And one of the key verses that came up an awful lot was Matthew 28, 19 and 20. And Jesus said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. Well, we were working in Africa, so that was one of the all nations. But do you realize that Hartley is part of all nations? Hartley Sanborn, this community around us, part of all nations. Think of that at the beginning when you see the word go there for, the first thing comes to your mind, oh, God's going to send me off to the middle of Africa. Well, right now, in the middle of winter, I think going to the middle of Africa would be kind of nice. But that's not why he's sending us. He's sending us to make disciples. But one of the ways you can look at that is not that you have to get up and go, but the idea that as you are going. I love the way that someone put that once, and I don't know who coined the phrase, but the idea is, as you are going, make disciples. That's your job. It's my job. It's all of our job. As you are going, you shine your light in your community and let people see God so they will glorify and follow him. In Acts, he gave another commission, or this kind of the same idea, right before he left and went back up to heaven. Acts 1:8, Jesus said, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be my witnesses both in Jerusalem, in Judea, Samaria, and even the remotest part of the world." You can easily translate that into Hartley, O'Brien County, Minnesota, Nebraska, and even to China and the rest of the world. We have a commission. We have a job description. And so I looked at this Romans chapter 1, and I see, first Paul says, "I am not ashamed." Jesus once said, "If you deny me before men, I will deny you before the Father." It's not a very nice thing to think about. But it means that we have to be not ashamed of the fact that we have the gospel and we are sharing the gospel with people. "For I am not ashamed of the gospel." We need to be able to spread that. Now, a lot of times you think automatically that that means I got to go stand on a street corner, or I got to be preaching, or I got to be doing some things. And, you know, if God gives you in those areas, certainly that's what he's calling you to do. But somebody else said, "Share the good news of Jesus Christ and sometimes use words." This morning in our Sunday school class, we talked a lot about the light, people being the light, just living their lives before God, and people see that and work through that. They get challenged by it, and sometimes they feel condemned by your life. That's not a problem, because God will use that to draw them to himself. God will use his light shining through you to glorify himself. So you don't need to worry about that. But don't be ashamed, and don't water it down. God gave us this gospel to share the good news with people around us. So, the gospel. I wanted to define that a little bit. And he says it's the power of God for salvation to the world. So let's just kind of break that down a little bit and go at it. The power of God. Why do we need the power of God? Well, in Hebrews chapter 4, or chapter 2, 14, it says that Satan has the power of death, but that Jesus came and defeated Satan. So when Jesus died and was resurrected, he defeated death, he defeated Satan, so now God has taken power back over death. He always had it himself, but he has given it to us through his Son, Jesus Christ. So the power of God has come into us to share the good news with people, and the power of God for salvation. What do we need to be saved from? Our sin. At the very beginning of time, Adam and Eve sinned, and it's been getting worse ever since. And God told them, if you eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you will die. And people have been dying ever since. Now Satan has been defeated. He's still out there working really hard, but he has been defeated. And the power of God has come over us, or over the death, and given us the power of eternal life. So we are saved from our sin through the power of God, but it is only for those that choose to believe, and that's where we come in. We share the good news with those around us so that they will believe. It's very, very important that you shine your light. I worked at Northwest Airlines for a number of years, and there was a guy that worked there. His name was Bill. He was about as foul-mouthed as anything I'd heard, even in the Air Force. And he always had a dirty story for everything, and he picked on me from one end to the other. I'd never really had a conversation with him as to who he was. Everybody that I worked with knew that my goal was to ultimately be a missionary in Africa and fly airplanes for missionaries. That was what I was planning to do. So those guys all knew that, and Bill played on that, and he played on that. Well, finally, the end of the 7 years that I was there came, and it was time for us to move on and get ready to go to the field, and they had a little going away for me. And I got some little gifts, but one that I'll always remember. Bill gave me a Bible. He said, I tried for 5 years to make you mad, and it didn't work. God is doing something. Last, I visited with him when we came on furlough, and he was teaching Sunday school somewhere. Wow. I never stood up and preached to that man, but God worked in his life.
Amen.
Amen. I see that book on my, or that Bible on my shelf, and I think of Bill. But that's what we can do. That's the Holy Spirit working through us. It's an exciting prospect that God has given us the power of salvation that we can share with others so that they can believe. I have some, Dave, we want to give these out. I wanted to share some stuff with you. There's a lot of little tools that people can use when it comes to sharing the gospel. You might have heard of the four spiritual laws. There's one with discipleship ministry of some sort. There's a lot of different varieties. In actual fact, the best tool you can use is your testimony. I was a sinner, God saved me. And your life is a testimony to them. But I came across this, this little thing. Everyone take one. Romans is an interesting book. When we started our latest series on what should we do now in Sunday school, David Jeremiah said that he challenged his church to write out the book of Romans, to get go down to the store, pick up a notebook, and sit down and in your own handwriting, write out the book of Romans. And I know two people here that have started to do that, and they found out what a daunting task that is, because you don't just write out the book of Romans. Mm-hmm. You get into it and you start finding out, and the Holy Spirit starts working in your life, and you start seeing things in there that you never knew existed. And it really gets you into studying deeper in the Word. Well, Romans is a long letter, and it's kind of broken down, and the first three chapters of it are kind of dismal. It's telling us that we're sinners. I mean, it's just kind of getting down on us, and then he starts getting into what we can do about it or what God has done about it, and then gets us down to where God has saved us. And then the last four chapters are kind of practical tools for living the Christian life. Well, somebody went out and created the idea of the Romans Road. And it's kind of like connect the dots through Romans. There's five key verses through Romans that talk about salvation. And it takes a step by step along with how Paul kind of outlined the book of Romans. And so I wanted to work your way down and just kind of highlight each one of those verses. So look at the thing that I sent out to you. The first one is, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." That's not most, it's all. The only person that ever lived on this earth that hadn't sinned is Jesus Christ himself. So everybody has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. That's true of all of us. And once we realize that, we realize that we have a need. You go down to the next one, into chapter 5, and it says, "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see on the board up there, "But God demonstrates his love for us." You've heard from people from time to time, "Well, you don't know how bad I've been. God can't save me." God didn't need you to get to a certain level of righteousness before he came to save you. He saved you right where you were at. So God demonstrated his love toward us in that while we were still in our deepest sin, Christ died for us. He died to take away that sin. What a phenomenal thought that is. It's for all of us. John 3:16 says, "For God so loved the whole world that he gave his only son, that whosoever believes in him will have life, eternal life." So then we go on to 6:23. And we find out everybody's sinners. And what do you get for being a sinner? "The wages of sin is death." Now here they're not talking necessarily about just the end of life on this earth. They're talking about eternal separation from God. That's death. That's true death. And that's what God was talking about when he told Adam that you will die. You will be separated from me if you sin. "For the wages of sin is death, but..." Don't you love those buts? "But the gracious gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." The gift of God is eternal life. Not, okay, if I do this much, then God will do the rest. God did it all. And I go through these things, not because you don't necessarily know them, but I find them very encouraging to go back through them and back through them. For my own life, when I get down a little bit, I love to go back to John 3:16. I love to come back to these verses because it's such an encouragement for us as we go through life. Satan is on the attack all the time, so don't forget him. But these are part of your testimony. This is what God is sharing with, has given to you. "So the wages of sin is death, but the gracious gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." No longer. The power of God defeated Satan, defeated death, and now we have eternal life through Jesus Christ. But it is only for those who believe. So then we go on to chapter 10. "So if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved." Not might be, not maybe, will. You put your trust in Jesus Christ. You're admitting that I'm a sinner. I can't do this myself. I trust you. You will be saved. You will have eternal life. That is the message of the gospel. That's what we have to share with people around us. And then on to verse 13 in the same chapter. "For everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved." Now, if that doesn't give you a lift, I'm not sure much can. That is an exciting message. It's a way for you to share the good news with those that may come and ask you. Peter tells us to always be ready to give a reason for the hope that is within us. Do you have hope? If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, that's your hope. It's not like a hope that it might happen. It's a hope that it will happen. we will be with Christ someday in eternity. And we have already defeated death. God defeated death, and so we don't have to worry about it. That is an exciting message for us to share with the people around us. You have the opportunity when you walk out these doors to live your life for God, to shine your light before men so that God will be glorified. One of the things that we have been going through in Sunday school is to do with prophecy and what's coming at the end of time. And we don't know. Christ said that nobody knows when the actual time will be. Only God has reserved that for himself. But it will come. But he did say that some of these things are going to happen, and you will know that it is about to come. And so we look at some of the things that are foreshadowing that tribulation period that's coming and the second coming of Christ. We look at those things and we see some things coming together. It was astounding when COVID hit how quickly world power and government grabbed the reins and how quickly they got hold of it. I mean, I was absolutely surprised. I have always looked at prophecy and thought, it's going to take some time to pull that together. It didn't take any time at all. These people are ready. Satan is ready to take over the reins and run this world into the ground. That's his goal. Before the tribulation, we believe the rapture will happen and the church will be gone. And that's an exciting prospect. And we look forward to that. But the problem is anybody who didn't believe in Jesus Christ will still be here to go through the tribulation. That's something we need to think about. We've got friends, we've got people we know. Each one of you has a unique community of friends that only know you, or only know you as a Christian. And you have the opportunity to share God with them, to share the good news of Jesus Christ with them. The Holy Spirit lives in you if you are a believer, and it's his power that will work through you. That power, the power of God in you, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with those around us. That's a phenomenal thought. Even if, we look at this and we think, okay, we got to be on the verge. Someone I listen to up in Minneapolis says, we're not in the last hours, we're in the last minutes. The rapture's going to happen any minute. And that's very likely true. But even if God decided that he was going to last out another 1,000 years before he did that, the fact of the matter is that everybody is going to die at some point. And if they die without Jesus Christ, they have something even worse than the tribulation to face. That is an eternity separated from God. Bad as the tribulation is going to be, an eternity separated from God is something I don't much like to think about. And if you look at people around you and you realize without God, they have no hope, that's a challenge. You have a commission. As you are going, go ye therefore into all the world, all the nations, and preach the gospel to Hartley and Sanborn, O'Brien County. It's a challenge, but you have the power of God living in you. And, sometimes without saying a word, God will work. Let's pray. Lord God, challenge us, work in us, work through us. None of us are great orators or phenomenal people that everybody wants to be just like. But when you shine through us, People want to live their lives as you live your life through us. We thank you for that. Work in us, challenge, work through us, and help us always to share the light of your gospel with the people around us. Be with us as we go out from here, as we walk out these doors. Pray that people will see your good works in us and that they will glorify you in heaven. Thank you, Lord. In your name, amen.
All right, please stand and join us.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us past the waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, O God.
Sunset falls upon your days and fades throughout the west as evening comes and lulls your souls to rest. May you follow Jesus. May he be your guiding light as you walk through this world, as you interact with others and spread his love. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen.